in here on this rainy day, and we lost an hour. How many can feel it?
Yeah.
Oh, I can feel it. Brother Judy, can you feel it? All right. Well, praise the Lord. We just thank God for the change of time. We'll have a longer day. Is that right? The days get longer? Amen. So that's a good thing. Amen. I want to just say this, that I want to encourage you to do your homework. The reason why we're doing this is because of schedules. Our schedules are really, really working havoc to the continuity and the bringing together of things, and it's just very difficult to try to catch everybody at the same time. So we have profile of a true disciple that will catch everybody. And I got to figure out how I can hook up with those that don't show up on Wednesday night. That's the only thing. And I'm going to see if I can hook up with every person, because if I can get everybody on the same page, get everybody flowing together, working through the same material, and get everybody in the flow of the Spirit in prayer, I think that we could be very unique in terms of ministry, because even the largest churches and ministries in this city, you will have just a very small people, a group of people on Wednesday night. And one of the biggest churches here, amen, you only have about 7 or 8 cars on Wednesday nights. Amen. So I know that when we get away from our discipline, the Bible study, praying in the Spirit, brokenness, fasting and prayer, and carrying out the Great Commission, in other words, being concerned about the lost, strengthening the hand, amen, of those in need. Amen. We got to be concerned about those in need. Is that right? We got to be concerned about those in need. And I want to challenge the brothers, amen, let's get into every home where there is a brother that's not coming to this church, and let's begin to share. Let's begin to share. Amen. Praise God. It's time to share. Now, if you can't connect I think sometimes we need to go into homes. Many times we can reach people by phone. I plan to connect with a whole lot of members. Maybe by phone, I might get where I can talk to several members at one time. But I got to find a way to pray with members. Last night, I just went down the list and started praying for members. I mean, I called them and prayed with them. I mean, these were members, you know, that are not able to come and be in prayer. So I'm concerned about each and every one of you. Amen. If somebody wasn't praying, if somebody wasn't concerned, if you didn't have a church, amen, that prayed and that travailed and that really hung in there, whether it was one or two, if you didn't have a faithful few people that's praying, amen, we could just be written off almost at any time. It wouldn't work. Because prayer, the scripture says the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous does what? Avails much. So that's, those are the disciplines that cause any church to go. Amen. I was shared one morning about, I was in Arkansas last week, and my brother has made a practice of being in prayer every morning at 6 o'clock. Amen. And he has prayer people that are there at 6 o'clock. He has prayer people that's there at 9. And you'd be surprised of how many people all over that city have been impacted just through the prayer group. The prayer group going into homes. The prayer group praying and interceding at that church. You would be surprised. So he has a ministry in Pine Bluff, Little Rock. And he has, he buries the dead. I'll tell you about it. Buries the dead too. Okay, so the path to spiritual breakthrough, I want you to feed on this, because this is going to help you with your consecration. the path to spiritual breakthroughs. Praying with all prayer, a guide for scripture prayer, and subduing the flesh. Everybody heard that? Subduing the flesh. Those are the keys, amen, to spiritual breakthrough. Praying with what kind of prayer? All prayer. And this is going to show you how to pray with all prayer and what these prayers are. Amen. You will just walk it. If you could use this for a devotional tool in the morning, amen, you will just lay it out. It will just be like Pastor Hill, amen, sitting by your bedside. You might not see me during the week, but Pastor Hill will be right there. Amen. And I want to see saints, because I'm concerned, because there's a lot of scriptures I'm going to share today. Some of the scriptures show that in the last day, just before Jesus comes, there are going to be conditions that prevail, and that's going to cause many saints just to what? Just to give up. Give in. You're going to get weak, fall out, faint, and die, because they get in the way from what? Foundation. They get in the way. Amen. I'm trying to get y'all back to it. Is that right? Ain't that a good pastor?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Some of y'all probably just don't like for me to be up here howling and barking and praying, singing in the spirit. And you say, oh, pastor, don't take all of that. Are you, do you have problems? No. The reason I pray like that is because some of us got some problems. And I know that, what? Somebody will have to pray so you can, what? See the light. I'm praying the eyes of our understanding might be what in light. Because most times we can't see what's going on with ourselves. Somebody going to have to look out for you. Big time, we don't see nothing going on, you know. That's causing any problem. All right. Well, I'm playing the role of a pastor. Soul winner's manual. Amen. Before you get to heaven, you're going to have to go through this. Amen. No souls. No, amen, doing the work of the ministry. No rewards. Everybody can say no rewards.
No rewards.
Amen. That's not okay? No reward? Mm-mm. All right. Soul winners manual. Show you how to win souls. And to lead people, all of these people around us, we can't find a single person to take us up on what we got. Amen. We just need to what? Pray and let the Holy Ghost begin to what? Take over, lead. Amen. Everybody can say amen.
Amen.
The Lord's compassion. That's all of the teachings I've done the last 2 or 3 months on compassion. You're going to find that this is going to help a lot of people. If you can share this with them, if you can digest it, meditate it, all of the things that Pastor have taught the last 2 or 3 months on compassion. Amen. Why does the Bible place so much emphasis on healing? Amen. Why does God? Okay, we're going to share this with you. God is a Father of mercies. Why all of these numerous mercies are possible? Why are these mercies? What area of God's word is most capable of inspiring your faith? We have, oh gosh, a lot of information. Y'all heard bits and pieces, but it all comes together in this little manual. Placing yourself in a position where God's compassion can reach you. The Lord's compassion meditations and declarations. Okay, you have all of these scriptures that I've been quoting, talking about praying and singing. All of these all compiled. All in this little book. How does the compassion side of God relate to his judgment side? You want to know that. And a powerful illustration of the power of God's love. Amen. All in these little books here. And of course we got out of prayer, prevailing prayer, confessions. We just ran several more of these. Amen. So all of these are at your disposal. Amen. Praise God. And I want to do something very special for those that following the teachings that we have recommended on Tuesday night. I mean, on that Wednesday, we recommend chapter 2, having God's interest at heart. That's what we studied this past Tuesday night. Wednesday night. Amen. We're going to finish that up, answer those questions, and throw in some new revelations. And when I call you on the phone, I'm going to ask you, have you done chapter 2? All right. I'm going to talk, y'all don't believe this, I'm going to talk to some of y'all personally. Otherwise, amen, y'all going to miss the mark even sitting under the power of this teaching. Amen. Okay, so I'm going to share with you something that's going to really bless you. Having God's interest at heart, why is that so important? Having God's interest at heart, I'm just going to just talk from that. It's because, that's so important, is because that God is going to hold us accountable for certain things. And I'm going to share some things that God is going to hold us accountable for. In other words, your rewards and what happens to you, what position, what role you play when you get to heaven is going to be contingent upon these things that I'm going to mention today. And it's very, very important that you listen well. Amen. And I also want to just say that the fact is that suppose we just don't do anything at all for God. Suppose we just let all of the different things that the enemy and, you know, of course, we talk about the cares of life and all of that, but there are many things the devil has placed traps and snares at our doorstep, and he wants to lure us into a state of spiritual inactivity. There's a lot of traps. I'm going to just share some of them. Y'all have heard these before. These are traps that can rob you of your pure and sincere devotion. Satan wants to defeat us. He wants us to lose our souls. And he wants to keep us from being rewarded when we get to heaven. He doesn't want us receiving the reward. See, if we don't do certain things, if we don't do the works that our faith demands us to do, faith without what? Works is what? Dead. That means that we were insincere and we can't be rewarded. And also, your soul will be at jeopardy too if you don't do things. Faith without works, dead faith, people with dead faith, amen, not a living faith, dead faith, many of them are not only going to lose their rewards, but they're going to lose their souls. They're going to lose their souls. See, there's a category of people that's going to lose their souls because they did not do, amen, anything, amen, hearted at God. Remember the parables of the pounds and the, what else? The pounds and the talent. Is that right? Amen. The person that had all of these gifts and the Lord left, gave him 1 pound or whatever. When he came back, what had he done with that? He hadn't done what? A single thing. Was he saved? No, he was cast into outer darkness. So you want to listen good to make sure that you're not going to be in the category where people, amen, have dead works, you know, very few people are going to be in that category. But if you stop Bible study, if you stop pursuing the disciplines, you can come to the point where all of your time is going to be what? Focused at what? Doing stuff other than the will of God. And you can actually lose your soul after you have done a whole lot of good things for God. And the Bible mentions about the things that you you did when you were on track are not going to be remembered if you what? Amen. If you start going in the other direction and refuse to what? To heed the warning. Amen. All of the works you've done, many works might have been good, but if you don't heed the warning and turn back and just stop, throw up your hands, and just let circumstances and situations just keep you from everything, and praise God, and you can't obey God in no area, honey. Amen. You can mess around and you can actually lose your soul. Amen. So, Bible said, I'm from the Holiness Church. I don't know where y'all from. They said, follow peace with all men and holiness without which what? No man, says he the Lord. Holiness simply means that what? You're walking out what God has commanded you to do. You're walking it out. You're doing it. You're being a doer of the works. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, some of the things that the enemy has laid at our doorstep, and these things can be a snare. The scripture says in Luke 21:34, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day can come upon you unaware. For as a snare shall it come on all of them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Okay, now that's one thing that can really get you off track and begin to lead you down, amen, to the primrose path, where scripture says there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of what? Death. Amen. Overcharged with surfeiting. Your heart's overcharged with surfeiting. That means that as we get closer and closer to the coming of Jesus, we need to restrain our appetites. Jesus did it. Paul did it. All of these men that we respect, that were great leaders, they were people that were able to what? Restrain their appetites. You can't eat every meal. You can't get up in the morning frying bacon every morning. Amen. You ought to have 2 or 3 days a week where you set aside at least until afternoon where you just don't eat so you can what? Get your spiritual focus and God will begin to talk with you. Now just these little 3 days, we just did the juice and the fruits and the vegetables and things like that. Amen. Many of you, amen, have witnessed that your experience, your fellowship began to what? Take a turn. You began to feel a freshness. Your prayer life was what? Was inspired. Amen. Things came to me this week that, amen, that don't normally come to me because God was just speaking to me very, very intimately. Amen. So, you know, so we're going to have to push back the plate some so that we can, amen, hear the voice of God. Amen. How many of you that you can just eat up all of your spiritual progress? Just eat it up. Amen. We're going to do some teaching that tells you the detriment physically that's happening when you are not temperate, when you're just eating everything that you feel like you're big enough to eat. Amen. All of the acid food that we're eating is the reason why you have all these sudden deaths. People, you know, not expecting nothing to happen to them. All of a sudden, suddenly, the acid, amen, level gets to a certain point. Amen. And then what happens is that, amen, everything shuts down. Amen. So God doesn't want us to be like the world. Amen. Turn to this. This is the scripture. This Ezekiel 16:49. This is a very good scripture. It's very similar to the scripture that we just read. Behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom, pride, fullness of bread, and abundance of idleness was in her and in her daughters. Okay, now these are the things that will take every nation down. This will take every believer in reverse. It's going to zap you. It's going to be detrimental to you. It's going to work against you. And it's going to place you in a position where the enemy can actually, amen, blow a devastating blow to your life. These are the things that are going to get you out of the ark of safety. So you need to be aware that when Pastor Hill is asking you to refrain from eating a few days, amen, and get your Bible lessons worked out, these are things that we just got to do if we don't want the enemy to work havoc and to place us out of the range where God's mercy and God's grace can help us. Amen. All right, so this is the reason why this city was destroyed. Pride, in other words, pride is no more than coming to a point, I don't need nothing. No, amen. I got all I need. I'm all right. Amen. Can't nobody tell me nothing. I got all I need, and I don't need to fast. I don't need to pray. I don't need all of this. Amen. That's pride. Pride comes before what? Destruction. And a haughty spirit before what? Fall. Amen. So you better listen, because you better believe that pastors see a whole lot more than you see. Sometimes I see things, well, I wish I could say something, but I can't. If I said something, people will be offended. Even the thing the Lord shows me, well, sometimes I cringe. I said, Lord, how long will you permit this to go on? Amen. All I can do is just pray and cry. Pray and cry. Amen. Praise God. I believe because somebody is praying from their hearts, amen, has hindered a whole lot of things that would have happened that haven't happened. Amen. But how long will it last if you don't do anything at all? Amen. I know I'm not preaching like I want to preach, but I'm telling you some things that will really help you. I'm from the old school, y'all. All right. We had certain days that we fasted and prayed. We had certain times we came together and what? Shut in for 3 days. Everybody stopped eating. All right. Those were the days when people loved the Lord.
Amen.
Those were the days when people came to church and they felt like they had been to church when they went back home.
Yeah, that's right.
Is that right? These were the times that you couldn't, sometimes you had to hold up church for an hour for the Spirit to have His way. Amen. But when things begin to dry up, nobody can find time, nobody can fit it in. We can fit everything else in.
All right.
Amen. Praise God. Somebody give me a fan.
All right.
All right. Pride, fullness of bread. Fullness of bread. Fullness of bread. Eat every meal, almost. Every meal. 2 or 3 times a day. And sometimes in between. Before time, ahead of time, on time, and all the time. Amen. Now, the reason why I'm hitting this, this fullness of bread, because an American pastor graciously sympathizing with a poor Ethiopian pastor related his concern. Amen. This is what the American pastor told the Ethiopian pastor. I pray for you in your poverty. See, over here we got bread to spare. Full. Everybody's full. Amen. Everybody's full. If you don't, if you ain't able to buy it, you can get food stamps. Right? Everybody's full. Anybody hungry? Raise your hand. Who ain't got some oatmeal in the cupboard? Amen. So everybody is prosperous compared to people in other lands in America. And when God begins to bless us, when God begins to give us food to the fullness, amen, then what's the next step? Amen. God is going to cause leanness. He's going to permit leanness in the area of your soul. You're going to begin to get lean in your soul. See, this is what happened to Israel. He fed unto the full. He fed unto the full. In other words, he provided all this food, all these quails, and I mean, they had all the food. I mean, food was running out of their ears, my mouths. They were vomiting up food because they ate so much. Everybody had 60 baskets full of quails. So everybody, he sent bread to the full, but he sent leanness to their soul. Amen. So, all right. So, when prosperity comes, when fullness of bread, when God begins to bless us, that means that we need to be more prayerful. We need to be more what? Diligent. We need to what? Push our place back so that we won't get caught up in being over. Everybody say overcharged. How many? Sometimes overcharged, you get so full that you just amen. All you can do is grunt. Pass gas and grunt. Sometimes we mix up so many different things together, boy, you're full of gas. You say, oh, you know, I gained this much weight. You just puffed up. So you won't have that problem if you ate raw vegetables and fruit. And that's what we were trying to get you back to. And it's a hard road to hoe. Getting people back to raw food, that's foods in which have all of the ingredients to nourish your body. Amen. Things that can bring alkalinity to your body, bring it in balance, cause your body to heal itself. And that's the reason why we recommend people to eat alkaline. You know, sometimes I think fasting would be good if we would just could use it. So, Lord, I just want to use the consecration just to get back to alkalinity. Because I know as long as my body is out of balance, it's more acidic than alkaline, then I'm dying. See, it's life only in what? Life, which is raw vegetables and fruit. You gotta have that, saints. I mean, you ought to be shouting the victory that Pastor Hill called a consecration and just tell you to eat raw stuff. Sometimes I don't want no raw stuff. I don't want that kind of stuff. I want something I can put my hands on. Chicken hip. I want a half a chicken. That's normally what I like, a half a chicken at a time. Fried with potatoes. A lot of potatoes. Macaroni. Potatoes and macaronis. Oh, I'm telling you, I'm going to have Derek one day to talk with you about why so much sickness and disease are happening. And why so many people are having strokes, having heart attacks, aneurysms. And you'd be surprised. I mean, you have to go a long way before you can find a person that drank water. Half of your body weight in ounces. That's the minimum. That ain't even enough. Half of your body weight in ounces ain't enough water for you. See, I'm being more inspired to really begin to preach healing, because if you can get people to learn how to balance their body and teach them how to bring their acidic state into alkaline state, you're going to be able to get people healed a lot easier than you ever thought, and keep them healed. And we passed this out Wednesday night, this cardiologist from Obama's colleague. He's a top cardiologist in the country. He's the one that Clinton and the Bushes and all of them used. And he said that everybody ought to be drinking condom water. See, I'm telling y'all some good things, whether y'all receive it or not. I'm telling y'all some good things. He said that hundreds of thousands of my patients, now hundreds of thousands of them, are recommended. He said, I'm bringing this to the medical community because we've been trying for decades to bring people's bodies into balance so that the body can heal itself. But we have not been able to do it even with, amen, raw fruits and vegetables, because it's so hard to get people to eat that and to eat enough and to eat it consistently. He said, but now if you can get people to fill their bodies full of this alkaline water, he said that means that their bodies will have all of the at the lineage that it needs in order to overrule or override all of the acidic state and bring their body into balance, and the body will begin to heal itself. The body will, I mean, you have, amen, a lot of these guys stepping forth now, telling us things that we can do naturally, amen, to really enhance ourselves. So I think it would be great if we could just, what, pull back and listen and try to get off of meat. Is that right? Get off of all this meat and junk stuff. Amen. Some of us eat a half a gallon of ice cream one time. Amen. You may get off that, amen. I'm taking too much time on that, but that was the sin of Sodom. It was fullness of bread, abundance of idleness. Amen. Amen. Abundance of idleness. That means that too much time watching TV, doing stuff that's not going to what, build you up spiritually. Count all of the hours you are doing stuff that's not enhancing you spiritually that you are doing. And count the hours that you're actually doing something that's going to make a difference in terms of whether you receive a reward or not. Amen. So we better begin to kind of think through, because if we don't, if this diplomacy with Iran doesn't work, and we can't, amen, get Iran and Israel, amen, praise God, really, amen, acting like they should act, amen, we might have Armageddon starting real soon. All of these players are players in Armageddon. So time is much shorter than we think. We think we got years and years and years and years and years. But I think, amen, we need to live as if this might be the last year. This might be the year that will trigger the Armageddon conflict, which will be 3.5 years. It will trigger. When Armageddon starts, it's going to be a continuous conflict until all the nations of the world are involved. All of the nations. Alright, so abundance of idleness. Amen. That means we need to get back to our what, Bible lessons, working them out, get back to reading. This month, St. John, right? The right St. John, and all of these little books here that's designed to get you back into what? Consecrations of doing the flesh, getting control, the path to spiritual breakthrough. Amen. The Lord's compassion. Get back to things that lay in the foundation. Everybody just say, lay in the foundation.
Lay in the foundation.
Amen. Amen. Lay in the foundation to do the works of Jesus. Because when Jesus comes, amen, the issue is going to be your works. Everybody just say, your works. The issue is going to be your works. And I'm going to point out the areas that are going to come into play. Amen. But I want to just finish this up. Abundance of idleness in her and her daughter. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. That means that things which are vitally important, these are the things that Jesus left us in charge of when he went away. We are to continue to do the things that Jesus began to do and teach. Amen. And that is the scripture. Amen. And I have so many scriptures, but my time, Sister Hill is here, she'd be waving the flag right now. There are scriptures which says that, amen, abound more and more in love toward one another and toward all men. The Bible says it over and over, increase the fruit of your righteousness. I mean, there are so many scriptures admonishing us to work the works of him that has what sent us while it is day, because when night cometh, no man. Now, whose light are we sowing in? Amen. Whether they listen or not, Whether they receive what we have or not is our responsibility. What? To what? Carry the word. Strengthen the hand of the poor and what? Needy. Amen. Now, that's very, very heavily up on my heart. Strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. Now, let's turn to Philippians 1. I'm just going to read that. These are the things will count, and these are the things that's going to build you up. These are the things that's going to cause you to be established in holiness. Now, I remember years ago, we were teaching people to be holy, be holy, be holy, be holy. But we said, amen, don't wear your dress too long. Amen, don't wear your sleeves too short. Is that right? Don't wear makeup, don't wear pants, don't wear all of this. Amen. It was a bunch of do's and don'ts, right? But holiness is, amen, is more, amen. How do you get established in holiness? How do you actually get established in holiness? Now, I'm going to show you how you get established in holiness. Amen. Philippians 1, verse 9 and 10. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. See, love has to abound more and more in knowledge. That means that you have to really get established in grace, the word of God. Amen. See, Paul said, I commend you by the word of his grace. Amen. Be established, you know, in righteousness. He said that the word of grace is the thing that's going to establish you. Amen. So the knowledge got to be a part of the process. Knowledge, 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 knowledge. Okay? Yet more and more abound, yet more and more knowledge, and in all judgment. Well, watch this. That you may approve things that are excellent, that you be sincere without offense to the day of Christ. So these are the things that enables you to be sincere without offense, amen, by you abounding more and more in love. See, the more you reach out, the more you help, the more you sow, the more that you work the works of Jesus. These are the things that will purge you, cleanse you, and keep you focused. You heard Brother Scales said every time he comes, he said that all of the hang-ups that I had, I was a pimp, I was a drug addict, I went to prison, what else did he say? Women. He was a, what you call those? Amen. Guy that chased women. Amen. He had so many addictions. He had so many hang-ups and problems. He said that the only way that I could stay free after the Lord saved me, he said, I had to go out and win soap every day. I remember when he first came to our house, amen, here's his pattern. You would hear him in the room praying in the spirit. He would spend quality time reading the Bible because I would see him reading the Bible. But every day he would go out and win a soul. He would go out and talk to somebody. He might not have won a soul every day, but he would talk to somebody. As long as you do things basic like that, you're not going to have a tendency to get entangled with the affairs of life. That's the thing that keeps you on track, because there's a lot of inspiration and zeal and fervor and strength and power and anointing coming from what? Abounding in love.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Abounding in love. Now, just like last night, everybody can do this. Just try this. Call people and just pray with them. See how encouraged you will be on the phone. You don't have to go over there. Just what? Call them and what? Pray with them. You know, last night I just said, I'm going to build myself up, because after fasting sometime, you just don't feel the anointing the way you want. And I said, how can I get this anointing really pumping in me? I said, I'm just going to call my fofo, and I'm just going to what? I ain't going to condemn them, because I ain't seen them in a long time. I had a tendency to pounce on them. But the Lord just said, just pray for them. Don't even talk about they ain't been there. Just pray on them. Just pray. Boy, I prayed until I cried. I prayed until I broke. Then I hear them breaking down. Woo! My God. Talking about somebody pumped up after about four calls.
Amen.
Amen. Things like that. You ain't going to have time to be thinking about a whole lot of devil, man. So that's the key to staying on track and being without offense, sincere without offense, and living a life free from sin. There are certain disciplines you can follow that will absolutely cause you to live a perfect and upright life. And you ain't going to want to get what? Entangled with stuff that's not going to satisfy and gratify you like the things that what are really feeding your spirit. You ain't gonna want to get involved in that. Okay, I gotta.